684. 684. We'll send the first verse and last verse of this as well. Let's sing. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through.
To be commanded. for us to obey as he commanded. The seed of woman will carry throughout history and life to Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrifice, and the one who will be our Lord. Creator God, Jehovah God, as John Adam pointed out to us Wednesday night. This God saw fit to give this assignment to woman. And ultimately Mary, of course, we know, becomes a mother to Jesus Christ. And so it's very fitting this morning that we give honor and praise to our mothers, to our ladies, for their role within our lives, their role within our families, their role within the church. And if I didn't get to you this morning as you came in to say Happy Mother's Day, and I know I didn't get to everybody, we do wish you a Happy Mother's Day this day. Now on a side note, because you know I like to keep y'all up to date, just in case y'all missed the pending new name for Mother's Day. To some today, it's Gestational Parents Day. Okay? Isn't that catchy? Isn't that catchy? Charlie's laughing back there. And if you're wondering, fathers, our day now becomes Non-Birthing Parents Day. Now that's what's kind of pending in our society. You know, the true origin, okay, of Mother's Day, I'm not quite sure. You know, exactly who started what and when started, you know, and all of that. But no matter what, it's proper because Holy Scripture in Romans 13:7 says, give honor to whom honor is due. And if there's anybody within our family, within the world, within the church, we should give honor to our mothers, our grandmothers, our ladies, because they are such a vital part of us. Now there are many, many reasons that we could list, but I don't know of one that's more than the love of a mother, the love of a grandmother, the love that our ladies have for the church. But within society, as gender roles seem to start changing, all right, within society, and these changes have now spilled over into the church. You know, I ask that each of you women, each of you mothers, each of you ladies, as a child of God, resist the efforts of Satan, okay, to attempt to change your role as God has set forth. Now, there are various reasons for that. Genesis 3:16, God says to the woman who will become Eve, in pain you shall bring forth children, your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And Paul reinforces this thought in the New Testament in 1 Timothy 2. Let a woman receive quietly her instruction, for it was Adam who was first created, and then Eve. And it was not Adam who was deceived, but the woman being quite deceived fell into transgression. Now, despite this assignment, we'll say, you have been given a very, very, very important role within the family and within the church. Matter of fact, your role, I think, undergirds the whole church. And you must understand that. And bottom line, folks, us men could not make it without you. And you don't receive the praise, honor, and glory due you as you should. And I hope I try to express that to you this morning. And the more you're aware of the role that you have as the wife, the mother, the grandmother, as a member of our spiritual family, the stronger the church will become. You ladies make us men stronger. While we have the leadership role, 10 different congregations, and I have found the same in each one. To you, we say thank you, and we do love you despite our stubbornness. You know, God has given you to us a fantastic gift of life, and that gift of life is brightened by you, our ladies, our wives, the mother of our children. You know, I've heard, and I believe it, that the most precious gift that we men can give to our children is to love and care for their mother. So men, are you unconditionally loving your wife? Loving the mother of your children? Are you showing her that you love her? Unconditionally now. Not if you get up and fix me breakfast. Not if you get up and do this. Not if you get up and do this. Unconditionally. You know, though, too often us men are too engrossed with ourselves. Too engrossed with our egos. Too engrossed with our own plans, with our own desires, all right, to give you the honor due you. Too often we forget, you know, that we picked you out of all the world. So since we picked you to be with us, to walk with us, why shouldn't we give you the honor? It kind of looks bad on us if we don't. Man's failure to honor their wives as a Christian husband should is sin. Too often we demand things, and men demand things that we shouldn't. Too often we cause problems that we ought not cause. We shout when we shouldn't. We lose our cool over petty things. We don't pick up our clothes in the middle of the floor. We don't take the trash out as we should. And we claim we can't hear it sometimes. But the worst thing we can do is to fail to give you, our wives, our mothers, grandmothers, the love, care, respect, and attention that we should have. Husbands, talking to you now, right, Reed? Ephesians 5:25, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Husbands, Ephesians 5:28, so husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself, for no one ever hated their own flesh, but nourished and cherished it. And I've mentioned this before, and y'all know this, and I'll pound it home as long as I can. 1 Peter 3:7, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, because they are a weaker vessel. Said she is a woman. Grant to her the honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life. Why, Peter? So that your prayers may not be hindered. Fellas, you want to go ahead and treat your wife, the mother of your children, in a bad way? Hey, God says, I won't hear you. I won't hear your prayers. Now, if God doesn't hear you, where does that place you in the eyes of God? You're removed. Men, do you want your prayers heard by God? Then treat your wives right. Treat the mothers of your children properly. Support them, honor them, love them. So on this first day of the week, in addition to this socially named Sunday being Mother's Day, we men need to remember our Christian roles. And give our wives the assurance of being loved, the understanding and support that they deserve, and the psychological peace that many times is so needed. Now this morning, there are many women in the Bible that I could have chosen to look at, but there's one particular lady, all right, who stands out to me. She always has. As being very brave, intelligent, scrappy, determined. Her story, I think, is often overlooked when considering mothers. Matthew 15:21 starts that, and also Mark 7:24 starts this story. But Jesus was traveling, okay, along the Mediterranean Sea through Tyre and Sidon when a Gentile woman comes up to him, described as a Syrophoenician. Also, Mark describes her as a Canaanite. Came up to him. Now, you got to remember that the Canaanites were those who inhabited the Promised Land as the people of God came in, okay? People of God pushed out the Canaanites. Didn't push all of them out. Some of them, you know, were still there. But they were still their enemies, let's say. Now, this woman is a mother who has a daughter that is demon-possessed. Every mother has seen their child ill. And of course the fathers have too. But you know, it's a bad situation when your child is ill. You don't feel good. It just messes everything up. It scares you. And of course the more severe the problem, the more stress we have. Well, look, demon possession, you can just imagine what the mother's going through. She's desperate for help. She's been thinking about it. At times, not knowing what she was going to do. So she finds Jesus. And she really adopted a cry of a street beggar when she shouts, "Have mercy on me." This woman continued to cause quite a stir and to make a scene, so much that the disciples tried to shoo her away. They found Jesus, "Get this lady away from you." Again, a mother will do anything for her child. Anything. Whether to protect it, to get assistance for. Mothers will not be silenced. I always liken it to a mother bear on the loose after her cub. Better get out of her way. Get out of her way. This mother is attempting to get assistance from a Jewish man who has ignored her with her initial pleas, who keeps walking on without stopping, who's surrounded by a group of Jewish men trying to keep her away. Now, what would you do, mothers, if this person is treating you like this? Well, I know what the men would do. Oh, man, what is, you know, I mean, getting a little irritated. I know it, men. That's the way we react. But there's no doubt that this woman has heard about Jesus, because we find out over in Mark 3:8 that many people from where she was from actually traveled to see Jesus, and they came back telling about all of the healings that Jesus had performed. So she went to find Jesus, and she was determined to get to him. But from what she said, this Canaanite woman knew more about Jesus than just being a healer. She said this: "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David." She uses a messianic title for Jesus. She's not a Jew, she's a Canaanite. This mother who comes to, and she dares publicly to address a man, much less a Jewish man who is considered by many to be a rabbi. But this lady, she considers Jesus to be more than a rabbi. Now, if your child was sick, terribly sick, wouldn't you do anything and everything in your power? I know you would, and that's what this mother's trying to do. She's trying to do everything that she can do. We would take our child to every hospital in the United States if we had to try to find a cure. And this lady had done the same thing. And she wasn't going to be deterred here, just a few feet from Jesus. You know, I've wondered about this before. Where's the Father? Where's the Father here? The guys I'm talking about us again. Are we standing over in the shadows somewhere? Do we not care about our child enough to go? Do we not have the courage to fight for the cure for our daughter? He may be close around watching, I'm not sure. But then again, you know, he may get on watching. I don't know. Fathers, think about it. Shame on us men. Because we often fail to give our ladies, our wives, our mothers, our grandmothers the support that they need. And I'm not talking about monetarily. I'm talking about mentally, spiritually, psychologically. I asked Stuart, did you call your mom? Well, I texted her. Well, I guess that in your age, that's pretty good. At least you've done that. I'd much rather you call her. You know, but this mother demonstrates faith in Jesus. All right. Even though she's not a Jew. She said, "Have mercy on me, son of David," she shouted. Jesus finally answers, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Basically, Get away from me. Get away from me. Men, what would we have done? Almost failed. What would we have done, huh? What would we have done? I know we just stormed away or whatever. I don't know. We might have headed for home after a comment like that. But that didn't stop this lady. She just kept coming. She said, "Lord, help me. Lord, help me." And then this is the answer that just blows me away. If I was still around by then, Jesus' answer to this question would have for sure got to me too much. I'm not sure what I would have done. Here's the request. Jesus tells this lady, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Very unusual way to say, hey, you're a Gentile and you're not entitled to the blessings of my children. What? Are you calling me a dog? Sure sounds like you are. Well, the nerve of you, men, what would we do? How would we react to be called this? You know, many try to soften this with saying, well, you know, it's really a small dog. It's not one of the big dogs. You know, it's a small dog, kind of a lap dog, maybe, you know. Well, a dog's a dog. That's what Jesus said. And he just summarily dismissed this lady with an insult and a slur. It'd be too much for me to handle, I'm afraid. I am doing better at ball game, you know. So I would, this probably wouldn't have bothered me that much, maybe. But you know, in this situation, the trait of the mother comes out. Okay? Whatever God has created within her comes out. And this inner self-determination, her forward-looking heart, her why am I doing this, comes out. It didn't faze this lady where it would have fazed us, the men. Maybe that's why we're at home. Wife told us to stay there. Mother told us to stay there because you're just getting in my way. But this mother's reply to take the children's bread, toss it to the dogs. The mother replied, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs under the table feed on the children's crumbs." Now, every one of us who got dogs and let them in the house know that's true. I'd be at the bar in the kitchen eating anything, and Socks is right there by me waiting. Very patient. If I drop a crumb, guess what? She's got it. She's got it. What a comeback. This is the greatest comeback, I think, in the whole world. The mother's quick, intelligent, determined. And she affirms that this meal that Jesus is offering, get this now, this meal is so abundant that this mother believes that just a crumb of this meal from Jesus will cause that demon within her daughter to leave. Many times our ladies have that ability to see things more clearly and rationally than we do with the men. And here's where the role of the woman, I think, is really highlighted as a mate, as a helper, as a fellow worker, as a member of the Lord's church. Wow. 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 Jesus concludes this give and take with the mother by saying, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." This woman, this Canaanite, this Gentile, she had succeeded in doing what the scribes and Pharisees even did not do. She had a give and take with Jesus Christ. I hate to use the word vested, but she had a give and take with Christ where she met Christ, let's say. And Christ was so impressed with her faith, with her determination, with what she was doing, he said, "Go for it, even though you're who you are." And you know, I think this is kind of a premonition of what's coming. Because you see, it won't be very long before these blessings, this meal that Jesus is offering, spreads to the Gentile nations, all of the nations. But this lady's willing to break all norms of society. She didn't stop when Jesus kept going. She didn't give up. She didn't give in. She demonstrated the love and determination of a mother. And I thank God for us here in our spiritual family that we have so many determined, talented, intelligent ladies, mothers, grandmothers. And to you we say we thank you and we love you. It's a valuable asset that you have. Don't waste it. But be of service. Be of service. No mother or woman should take their roles within the church lightly. So this morning, all us men, hey, we need to heap abundant praise upon the ladies in our lives. We rise up this morning and we call you blessed because of who you are, because of what you did, because of what you mean to us in this church. At the conclusion of Jesus' personal ministry, he informs the disciples and the apostles, Matthew 28:18, go. And here's where he shares the blessings that he first brought to the Jewish people. He says, "Go into all the world, all world, all the nations, not just the Jewish, not just Jewish nations, all the world, and make disciples. Let's teach and tell folks about me. And then baptize them. And then continue to teach them all that I command. If you haven't been baptized, if you haven't learned about Jesus, if you don't know exactly what he should be within your life, allow us to speak with you, allow us to talk with you, and hopefully we can share where you will be able to understand what Jesus wants from us, his children. We thank God for those promises and those magnificent blessings. If we can help you anyway, come forward now while we stand.
Are you ready? John chapter 19, verse 30. John chapter 19, verse 30. Verse 30 says, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Just for a few moments, I want you to dwell on that. The phrase, it is finished. What was finished? Just a few moments, we're going to take up the Lord's Supper. The elements are prepared here. Talk about that for just a brief second here. If you will turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 22, verse 19. Chapter 22, verse 19. If you take the bread and gave thanks and break it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me. Verse 20. Likewise, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. Also turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 11, 1 Corinthians 11, verses 25 and 26. Verse 25, and after the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Again, I ask John 19, verse 30, when he says it's finished, what is finished? You have a song book, can you? Turn to song number 39. Song 39. We'll look at the lyrics here first. Psalm 39 here. It says, angels are singing redemption's sweet song, wonderful thing, glorious thing. Shout the glad message and join the throng, sing redemption's song. Over and over the melodies ring, wonderful thing, glorious thing. Heaven resounds with the tribute they bring, singing redemption's song. Joy beyond measure awaits us up there, wonderful thing, glorious thing. Soon we shall join the angels so fair, singing redemption song. What was finished? Had redemption been delivered? Are we redeemed? Many times when I think about these passages in Luke and Corinthians, you know, a lot of times our minds reflect back on the horrific death, the death of Christ, in a somber attitude. But for a long time, I kind of missed the fact that we also celebrate the redemption that Jesus delivered. So not only should we be thinking about the death of Christ, but we should also be thinking about what he brought, the blessings, the gift he gave us, salvation he brought down. He brought redemption. So this morning, as you partake the Lord's Supper, just don't forget, we'll be singing redemption sweet song.
Amen.
pray for the cup. Dear Father, thank you for this cup that represents Christ's blood that was shed on that cruel cross of Calvary, Lord. Lord, I pray that one partake of it, take it in a manner to be pleasing in thy sight. In Jesus' name we pray.
Stand and we'll sing number 824. We'll sing the first verse.